July 1866, and they had come to a mutual conclusion that they had to establish a madrasa. And in the morning when Maulana Rafiuddin Saab woke up, he saw the line as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had outlined it. And the history of the madaris of Deoband, millions of kuffars have been produced. Maulana Anwar Shah Kashmiri Rahmatullah Alayhi, Allahu Akbar, it is said about him, he was Imam Bukhari, Ibn Hajar Asqalani, Allahu Akbar, all in one, he was a walking library. My dear brothers and respected elders, we begin in the name of Allah, and we thank Him and praise Him and glorify Him, and we ask Him to send His infinite mercy upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sent as rahmat for the whole of mankind and the whole of Allah's creation. We seek His forgiveness and ask Him to enlighten our hearts and fill our hearts with His love for His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to keep us all on the right path as long as we live. And when our time comes to leave this world, may He take us away on Iman. And on the day of Qiyamah, raise us in the Ummah of His beloved Prophet and unite us with Him in the high stages of Paradise. My dear brothers, Allah sent His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a guide for the whole of mankind and gave him the responsibility. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته, and to recite His verses upon the people, ويزكيهم, to purify them, ويعلمهم الكتاب, to teach them the book, والحكمة, and wisdom. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself did not learn to read and write, and in fact, even in the previous scriptures, one of his qualities is النبي الأمي, the unlettered prophet. But the revelation Allah gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam first and foremost began with Iqra, read. النبي الأمي, raised amongst Ummi people, but came to teach them. Came to teach the people. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself in another hadith said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ مُعَلِّمًا, I've been sent as a teacher. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged people to learn. And in fact said, طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيدَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ وَمُسْلِمًا, seeking knowledge is obligatory upon every male and female, every male and female Muslim. And especially the knowledge of Quran. As people who acquire the knowledge of Quran in the eyes of Allah are the best people. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ, the best amongst you are those who learn and teach Quran. And in the life hereafter, those who have acquired the knowledge of Quran and learnt it and used to recite it, Allah will give them a special rank and treat them specially, and will be said to them, اقرأ وارتقي ورتل كما كنت ترتل في الدنيا فإن منزلك عند آخر آية تقرأها. Read or recite and rise in the stages of paradise. Your abode will be at the final place where you recite the last ayat. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam similarly encouraged people to memorize his sayings. Whatever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and he taught people. The Prophet said, "Naddarallahu imran sami'a minna shay'an faballaghahu kama sami'ahu." May Allah keep such a man prosperous who hears anything from us and then propagates it as he has heard it. So to seek knowledge of deen to a level that a person understands what Allah wants from him and what is required of him and what deen is all about. The Prophet said, "Tafaqqahu fi deen," gain thorough understanding. Fiqh means faqiha yafqahu, to understand something properly and thoroughly. And the Prophet said, "Faqihun wahidun ashaddu ala shaytani min alf aabidin." One faqih, one person with a sound knowledge of deen, is more severe upon shaitan than 1,000 worshippers. And this solid understanding, proper grounding and understanding of deen, Allah gives to only those He wants to favor. مَنْ يُرِذِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. When Allah wants to bless someone or deal with someone favorably, the Prophet said, Allah grants them understanding of deen. And in another hadith it has been mentioned, خَصَلَتَانِ لَا يَجْتَمِعَانِ فِي الْمُنَافِقِ. There are two qualities, they simply cannot coexist in a munafiq. One is good character, and the other is fiqhun fi deen, understanding of deen. And Allah in Surah Munafiqun has said, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ. They are people who don't have fiqh, who don't have understanding of deen. Understanding of deen is a special favor and blessing upon Allah. And that begins with learning. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to teach people, and Sahaba ridwanullah alayhi majma'in learnt deen from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and passed it on to tabi'eens, and then they passed it on to the tabi'i tabi'een, aimma mujtahideen, salaf salihin. And in this manner, generation after generation, Allah has blessed us and this ummah, and they have been teaching and learning deen. And Allah has mentioned in the Quran, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتِ. Allah elevates those amongst you with iman and knowledge to lofty ranks, to high positions, to a high status in the eyes of people and in the eyes of Allah. In another verse in the Quran, Allah says, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say, how possibly can people who have knowledge and then don't have knowledge, how can they be equal? People with knowledge, they have a special rank and a special status, a lofty status in the eyes of Allah. And Allah has mentioned the testimony of ulama with his own testimony. شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ. And some mufassirun have stated, if there was no other virtue of seeking knowledge other than this ayat, then this was sufficient for people to try and gain knowledge, and to encourage them to be considered in this mention. Allah said, Allah is a witness, and so are His angels and the people of knowledge to the fact that there is none worthy of being worshipped but Allah. So the testimony of ulama, along with the testimony of angels, with the testimony of Allah to His existence, and the fact that Allah is the one and only ilah. Such an honor, and on the day of Qiyamah, Allah will give a special rank and a special daraja in Jannat to the people of knowledge, to the ulama. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Inna al-ulama warathatul anbiya." The ulama are the successors, heirs to the prophets, because the prophets don't leave behind dinars and dirhams. Innama warathul ilm, they leave behind knowledge. And faman akhadhahu akhadha bihadhin wafir, whosoever acquires knowledge, then he has acquired a grand share. So the people amongst Sahaba Ridwanullah alayhi majmain who became famous with the knowledge, they are considered to be special. All Sahaba were special. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one hadith mentioned, لَا تَمَسَّ النَّارُ مُسْلِمًا رَآنِي أَوْ رَآ مَنْ رَآنِي. Any Muslim who has seen me or seen someone who has seen me, the fire of Jahannam will not touch them. So all Sahaba are special. But amongst the Sahaba, especially those who had dedicated themselves to learning the knowledge of deen, Allah made them more famous. Allah gave them more honor and more recognition, and they spread deen more. And to spread deen and teach deen, Allahu Akbar, that is in itself such a great honor. And this is a sadaqah jariyah, which lives long after a person has passed away as well. And one of the things the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that the reward of which carries on even after a person has passed away. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا مَاتَ إِبْنَ آدَمْ إِنْ قَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ. When a person passes away, his amal comes to an end. And some ulama explained that it means his own personal amal. He can't do anything himself afterwards, but the reward continues. إِلَّا صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ. If a person has left behind a sadaqah jariyah, or if a person has left behind knowledge from which people, or sources of knowledge, or arrangements or facilities for gaining or teaching knowledge, and the reward of this continues. And similarly, if a person has left behind a pious son or children who continue to pray for their parents after they have passed away. The reward for these things continue. So the personal practice or amal of a person comes to an end, but his reward can continue. And the ulama are the ones who have always come to the rescue of the ummah in their difficult times. Throughout the history of Islam, we see whenever the ummah has faced problems and difficulties, it has been the ulama that Allah raised, and they came to the rescue of the iman and the deen of the ummah. And the ummah has not faced such difficult times as we are facing now, and as the ummah has faced in recent times. As has been mentioned in his hadith narrated by Imam Bukhari, لا يأتي عليكم عام ولا يوم إلا والذي بعده شر منه حتى تلقوا ربكم. No day or no year passes upon this ummah except that it's worse than the previous one. In other words, each day to come, each year to come will be worse than the previous one. So the recent times have been the worst times this ummah has faced. And going back about 100 years, the ummah was going through very difficult times. The ummah has gone through very difficult times in the past as well. But in recent times, the ummah has faced very difficult times, especially with regards to their deen. The ummah has always regarded teaching and learning of deen as one of its fundamental responsibilities. In the early centuries of Islam, those with knowledge would teach in their localities, in their masajid, in their localities, and people would come to them to seek knowledge. People like Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu established his circle in Makkatul Mukarrama. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to hold a circle initially in Madinatul Munawwara and then in Kufa. And Allama Shamsuddin Dhahbi rahmatullah alayhi has narrated in Tazkiratul Hufaz, the students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu did not used to give anyone preference over him. This was because Allah had blessed him with such thorough knowledge. And then Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to hold his circles in Damishq. And then the subsequent generations, Ata bin Abi Rabah rahimahullah, he was the mufti of Makkatul Mukarrama. Then people like Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah used to teach in Kufa. Likewise, Sufyan Thawri rahimahullah, Imam Auza'i rahimahullah used to teach in Sham. But with the passage of times, Muslims also established institutions for learning deen. Jamiatul Azhar was one of the early institutions established by Muslims. It was established in the year 972 by a sect of the Shias known as Ismailis. And Ismailis hold Hazrat Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha in very high esteem. They consider Hazrat Fatima to be the most noble in Allah's creation. And because of her title being Zahra, Fatima to Zahra, they dedicated this institution to Hazrat Fatima, calling it Jamiatul Azhar. And then Salahuddin Ayyubi rahimahullah, in his conquest, when he conquered many parts of North Africa, including Egypt, then Jamiatul Azhar came in the control of the Sunnis and has remained so ever since. Until 1961, it was a purely Islamic university. And in 1961, the then president of Egypt, Jamal Abdel Nasser, also added some modern subjects to give it a modern status, Other khulafa and rulers, and they also established other institutions like Nizamiya was established by Nizamul Muluk in Baghdad in the 5th century, where Imam Ghazali rahmahullah studied and then became its headmaster, and many other famous scholars of that age studied there and taught there as well. But these were all institutions which were established by the state and funded and supported by the state. In recent times, Muslims have seen very, very difficult times. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا يَأْتِي عَلَيْكُمْ عَامٌ وَلَا يَوْمٌ إِلَّا وَالَّذِي بَعْدَهُ شَرٌّ مِّنُ حَتَّى تَلْقَوْا رَبَّكُمْ. Each day and each year which comes will be worse than the previous one. A Muslim ummah has faced very difficult times, but especially in the last 100 odd years, when Western powers spread their wings and colonized many parts of the world. The French colonized many parts of North and West Africa, and the British traveled further east and colonized many parts of the Eastern world, especially the Indian subcontinent. They initially landed in India in the later part of the 17th century and then spread trade bases on the coastal towns with the then Mughal Emperor Jahangir, with the permission of the then Mughal Emperor Jahangir. But slowly they established themselves and establishing army bases and spreading their influence and control to other parts of the of India, to the extent by the later part of the 18th century, they had taken total control of India with the exception of Punjab, where the Sikhs had established their rule throughout Punjab, from Amritsar in Delhi, Lahore, Rawalpindi, right up to Mansera up north, and Multan in south. Throughout Punjab, it was a total rule of Sikhs under Ranjit Singh. And they dealt very heavy-handedly with Muslims as well. And the British, having taken control of the remaining part of India, then dealt with Muslims very severely. And the whole infrastructure which the Muslims had put in place for many centuries, madaris, etc., were all dismantled, many were destroyed, many ulama in their thousands were massacred and martyred. And in their place, Bible societies, missionary colleges, missionary hospitals were established. And the British sent trained priests to debate with Muslims, and these priests would travel the length and the breadth of the country, challenging Muslims in open squares, on crossroads, and in main towns, insulting Islam and Muslims and even Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they were very difficult times, not only for Muslims, even Sikhs and Hindus considered the future to be very bleak for their generations to come. And in 1824, when the then Archbishop of Canterbury visited India, it is on record, he went on to say that because the British have taken total control of India and they control the land and the economy, so it is only right and appropriate that Indians should take up Christianity as their religion. And in the Parliament in London, it was said that they wanted to create a generation or a race of Indians who looked like Indians but felt and thought like British and Christians. So people, because the whole infrastructure had been dismantled, and the only facilities for gaining education, or the only solution for gaining education, were through these missionary colleges. And anybody who came through these missionary colleges Christianity was indoctrinated in them. And because the economy was controlled by the British, all official jobs were given to the people who would come up through these missionary colleges, having been indoctrinated in the Christian beliefs. So people felt pressurized and cornered into accepting Christianity. And then in 1857, many people, Muslims and non-Muslims alike, Hindus and Sikhs, thought that it is only right for people to try and stand up to struggle to achieve independence for them. And then in 1857, not only Muslims, but Hindus and Sikhs, they thought they have to stand up and struggle for their independence. Muslims united under Haji Imdadullah Muhajir Makki Rahmahullah. He became the Amir. Maulana Muhammad Qasim Nanotwi and Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi Rahimahumullah, who were his prominent disciples, they joined him along with Hafiz Zamin Shaheed, Maulana Muhammad Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayhim, and they all started their struggle from Thana Bhawan, which is in UP, and Allahu Akbar. And they spread out, conquering surrounding areas until they reached Shamali, where they suffered defeat and then had to disperse. And the British put out warrants for the, for their arrest, and promise reward for people who helped to arrest people, especially those who took an active role in the organization and leading of this. They called it the rebellion, and the Muslims considered this to be a struggle for independence. And in 1857, the father of Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani, instead of supporting Muslims in their struggle, he supported the British by giving 50 horses, in other words, 50 horses with 50 soldiers. To oppress the struggle for independence. The struggle was oppressed, and the Muslims who survived had to flee, and reward was offered to anyone who could assist in the capture of people who took part in this uprising, especially those who had helped to organize it and were leading the rebellion. And then people like Haji Imdadullah Muhajir Makki, Maulana Muhammad Qasim Nanotwi, Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, because they were prominent personalities and they had to go in hiding. Maulana Imdadullah Muhajir Makki, Rahimahullah, decided to migrate to Makkatul Mukarrama, and in secret he left India and proceeded towards Makkatul Mukarrama. Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, Rahimahullah, initially went into hiding, but he was captured and imprisoned for 6 months, and there was a fear that he would be killed, but Allah saved him. Maulana Muhammad Qasim Nanotwi Rahmatullah Alayh also initially went into hiding, but after 3 days came out in the open. People said to him, Maulana, you're a wanted man. And he said, I can't stay in hiding more than what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam stayed in hiding in the cave of Thawr for 3 days, so I just don't feel it right. And people were sent to look for Maulana Qasim, and somebody informed the authorities of the whereabouts of Maulana Qasim. They came to arrest him, and Maulana himself came up to greet them. And they didn't know who Maulana Qasim was. And Maulana Qasim, rahimahullah, took a few steps back and said, Maulana, he was here a few minutes ago. And the people thought that it's like how we say he was here, thinking that he has left. But Allahu Akbar, Maulana, Allah saved him. Allah had wanted to take special work from him. And in fact, Maulana Qasim and Maulana Rashid Ahmad, they had made mention to their spiritual master, Haji Imdadullah Sahab, that Shaykh, allow us to accompany you in your journey to Makkah, and we will go and settle there with you as well. Things are very difficult here for us. But Haji Sahab said, no, you must stay here. Allah will take very special work from you. And they didn't know what this special work would be, but Allahu Akbar. They remained in hiding for some time. After being freed from prison, Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, rahimahullah, returned to Gangoh and started teaching. Maulana Qasim spent much of his time traveling from town to town, until in 1860 he decided to go to Hajj. In secrecy, he traveled to Makkatul Mukarrama, and upon his return, it was announced that the people who had taken part in the amnesty, it was announced that anybody who had taken part in the uprising was granted amnesty. So Maulana Rahimahullah was able to then travel freely around Deoband and Nanota and Meerut. He had taken up employment in Meerut at the time, but because he had spent his childhood in Deoband, he was born in Nanota, but in the early years of his life he had come to settle in Deoband. He was then married there as well, and he grew up there, so he would travel extensively to Deoband. And he had some other friends, Maulana Zulfiqar Ali Sahab, Maulana Fazl Rahman Sahab, Haji Muhammad Abid Sahab, and Maulana Fazl Haq Sahab. And in Deoband there was a simple masjid known as Chattawali Masjid. It was like a hut, and they would spend much of their time there pondering over the situation, discussing about what Muslims can do and what they can do in order to safeguard the iman of the generation and the deen of the generations to come. And then by 1866, they had come to a mutual conclusion that they had to establish a madrasa. And at the time, they didn't know how to start about establishing a madrasa, because throughout the history of Islam, all these institutions like Azhar and Nizamiya and the madaris in Delhi and other parts of the world were all established by the state and funded and run by the state. And so now here there was a situation where the British, a non-Muslim ruling, non-Muslim rulers were ruling the country. So it couldn't have been expected of them to sponsor and provide facilities in order to establish a madrasa. And so after having extensive discussions, one day Sayyid Muhammad Abid Sahib Rahimahullah, after Fajr and after Ishraq, he decided to donate 3 rupees, and he took his rumal, his scarf, and put 3 rupees in it. And then he took the rumal to the scarf to some of his friends, Maulana Zulfiqar Sahib, and he gave 6 rupees, Maulana Mahtab Sahib, and then Maulana Fazl Rahman Sahib, and they all gave whatever they could. And Sayyid Muhammad Abid Sahib, by the end of the day, had collected 300 rupees. And in those days, 300 rupees was a lot of money, when the average wage was around 15 rupees per month. And so 300 rupees of those times are equivalent to around 300,000 rupees of modern times. And Sayyid Muhammad Abid Sahib then wrote to Maulana Qasim Sahib in Meerut that, Sheikh, we have collected 300 rupees, and as the discussions we used to have, it is now right time for you to come over and start the madrasa. Maulana Muhammad Qasim Sahib was looked up to, by his friends and comrades and associates. He was a very revolutionary personality, very knowledgeable, very humble, very pious, and very inspirational. In the struggle of 1857, Haji Imdadullah Muhajir Makki was the Amir, but Maulana Qasim was the general. And Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi Rahmahullah was the Qadi. So they wrote to Maulana Qasim Sahib, Sheikh, we have collected 300 rupees and we want you to come over and start this madrasa. Maulana Qasim himself did not want to come to the forefront and in the limelight, as it were, and he proceeded to one of his other friends, Mullah Mahmood, who was originally from Deoband, was also working in Meerut and teaching at the time. He approached him and said, Mullah Mahmood, what would you think if we were to offer you a job to return to Deoband, your homeland, and start teaching Islamic sciences there? And he happily agreed. And so he was sent by Maulana Qasim Sahib to Deoband in order to start the madrasa. Maulana Zulfiqar Ali Rahimahullah presented his own son Mahmood Hassan, who at the time was 15 years old. And on the 15th of Muharram 1866, in Deoband, in the forecourt of Chattawali Masjid, under a pomegranate tree, it will be a tree of Jannah. Allah has mentioned in Surah Ar-Rahman, Warumman. Under a pomegranate tree, Mahmood Hassan was the student, Mullah Mahmood was the teacher, and the first lesson was taught. And what a blessed day that was, and what blessed people. Teacher was Mahmood, student was Mahmood, and with such humble beginnings, they started under a tree, not even under the shade of a building or a masjid, in the forecourt of a simple masjid, under a tree. But Allah put so much barakah, and Allah wanted to take so much good work from these pious and sincere people that very soon that one became 21, and by the end of the year it became 78. By Ramadan, the number of students had increased to 78. And then, mashallah, the mashayikh, they were able to set up another madrasa in Shawwal after Ramadan in Saharanpur. There was another friend of Maulana Muhammad Qasim, his name was Maulana Muhammad Mazhar Nanotvi. He was similarly from Nanota, and he had also taken part in the struggle of 1857, and he was also a student of Maulana Ahmad Ali Saharanpuri. Maulana Ahmad Ali Saharanpuri was one of the teachers of Maulana Qasim Sahib. Maulana Ahmad Ali Saharanpuri became the Sadr Mudarris in Mazahirul Uloom, and Mazahirul Uloom was named after Maulana Muhammad Mazhar Sahib. Then the other madaris Maulana Qasim Sahib Rahimahullah encouraged ulama to establish in Meerut, in Glauti, and in Muradabad, and very soon a network of madaris was established. established throughout India with the inspiration and encouragement from Maulana Muhammad Qasim Saab rahimahullah. Maulana Qasim Saab had seen a dream when he was a young boy that he was standing on top of Baytullah and there were streams flowing from his fingertips and toes to all directions of the world. And he mentioned this dream to his then teacher Maulana Mamluk Ali Saab, and he said, Allah will take such work from you that Allah will establish, Allah will spread the knowledge of Islam to all corners of the world. And very soon, Allahu Akbar, other madaris started springing up. And wherever Maulana Qasim used to go, he would encourage people to establish madaris. And he would encourage communities to donate in this cause. And Darul uloom Deoband was the first madrasa established in the history of Islam with public support, with donations from the public. And Maulana Qasim had this written and instilled in the constitution of Darul uloom Deoband that never should there be any permanent source of income associated with this madrasa. And then he advised his associates that this madrasa will prosper and progress as long as there is no permanent source of income, because then this would lead the organizers and the management to keep their faith and trust in Allah. And then this is what Allah likes. When people trust in Allah, then Allah provides for their needs. And then also, it would give members of the public and the communities an opportunity to take part in this sadaqah jariyah, in this good cause. And when people, they assist financially, especially in any cause, then they regard it like their own. And Maulana wanted the people of Deoband especially, and the people of India generally, to regard Darul uloom Deoband and any other madrasa which would be started in their communities to be their own madaris and their own madrasa, and so that people can look up to these madaris for leadership and for guidance and inspiration. And Maulana, wherever he went, he would encourage people to establish madaris. And Darul uloom Deoband started with one student, one teacher. He then requested one of his other his friend since childhood, who was the son of his teacher, Maulana Mamluk Ali Saab, Maulana Muhammad Yaqub Nanotvi, who at the time was teaching in Ajmer on a monthly wage of 100 rupees. And Maulana Qasim Saab wrote to him and said, we have a purely Islamic responsibility and need, and I want you to come back to Deoband and start teaching here. And Maulana Yaqub Nanotvi, rahimahumullah, he'd grown up with Maulana Qasim Saab and knew him very well, and knew what sort of a personality he was. He could not refuse his request and gave up his job, which was a very good job at the time, earning 100 rupees a month, to come and teach in Deoband at 85%, at only 15%. Of the wage he was getting there, at only 15 rupees a month. But he happily agreed and he returned. And very soon, like we said, the number of students increased to 78 by the end of the year. Other madaris was also established. And Maulana Qasim Nanotvi Rahmatullah Alayh, although he spent much of his time in Meerut as well, but he would come back to Deoband every now and then. And some of the early students, especially Maulana Mahmood Hassan Saab, he would take him with him wherever he traveled. And there were other students like Maulana Ahmad Hassan Amrohi, and a few of other, and Maulana Fakhrul Hassan Gangohi rahimahullah as well. And they would spend much of their time with Maulana Qasim Saab. And because he knew, or he could see, the ability Allah had put in these special and blessed people, so he wanted to personally train them and personally teach them. And so they learned, they gained their knowledge from Maulana Muhammad Qasim Saab. And very soon, when students started to graduate from Darul uloom Deoband, other madaris which had been established in surrounding areas, then many of these students started to go and teach in those madaris and became teachers there. And very soon a whole network of madaris was set up throughout India. And then in 1870, Maulana Qasim Saab decided to go to Hajj again for the second time. And this time when they reached Makkatul Mukarrama, some of his associates, had they mentioned to Haji Saab, Haji Saab, we have established a madrasa in Deoband. Please make dua for its prosperity and progress. Haji Saab said, you say this is your madrasa. Do you know how many eyes have cried and how many heads have stayed in sajda throughout the nights and crying and praying to Allah to provide a means for the safety of Muslims and for the spread of Islam in India generally and throughout the world? And you say it's your madrasa. Implying that even people like Haji Saab in Makkatul Mukarrama in front of Baytullah had wept for years for Allah to provide a means for spreading the knowledge of Islam, where people can learn and teach Islamic sciences, Quran and Hadith and Tafsir. And Maulana Haji Imdadullah Muhajir Makki rahimahullah went on to say, I had been praying to Allah for a madrasa, and I used to think perhaps it might start in Thana Bhavan or perhaps even in Saharanpur, but little did I know that the people of Deoband will fly away with this honor. Many years earlier, Sayyid Ahmad Shaheed rahmatullah alayhi, along with Maulana Ismail Shaheed, in their travel, when they passed through Deoband, almost 50 years earlier, where the madrasa is in Deoband now, at the time, it was a place where people used to dump their rubbish, and Sayyid Saab rahimahullah, when he looked across, and he saw the state of the land, and he said to the people, Allahu Akbar, I smell the fragrance of knowledge flowing from here. Allahu Akbar. So the fact that there was a madrasa in Deoband, it was in the divine knowledge of Allah. It was destined that in Deoband, there should be a madrasa and a place or a lantern of knowledge, which should then enlighten the whole of India and the whole of the world. Allahu Akbar. And then, although Darul uloom Deoband was started under a tree, but as the number of students grew, then some of the students would be sent out to different masajids in Deoband. Deoband gets its name from the fact, some people have stated, that in the time of Sulaiman alayhi salam, he imprisoned some jinns in this area. In the Persian language, the word for a jinn is Deo. Deoband means imprisonment or sealing of a jinn. And so some people are of the opinion, some jinns were imprisoned in this area, hence it acquired its name, Deoband. Other people say that in the Indian languages, the word Devi means an idol or a goddess. And because in this area there was extensive worship of idols, hence it became known as initially Devi Band, then Deoband. Some people say that Deoband came out of idol worship, and Allahu Akbar, they make this a point of criticism, but can they not see that in Makkatul Mukarrama, in the house of Allah, before Allah raised His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the Baytullah, the historians have written there were 360 idols being placed there. So just because there was idol worship in a place, it doesn't mean that goodness can't come out of there. No, just as in Makkatul Mukarrama, in that house of Allah, which was built by Ibrahim Khalilullah, and which is a source of blessing and guidance for the whole of the universe, but at the time it was infested with idols, but Allah then spread guidance through there. Similarly, although in Deoband they might have been worship of idols, but just as in from darkness Allah can raise light and spread light, Allah showed His Qudrat and used Deoband to enlighten the world. And then when there was a need, when Maulana Qasim Nanotwi rahimahullah felt and there was a need now for Darul uloom Deoband, initially it was called Madrasa Arbi Islami. Then when they felt a need that they needed to build a building for Darul uloom Deoband, initially it was known as Madrasa Arbi Islami. And then at about 1874 they decided to build a building, and the day the construction was supposed to start and the foundations were supposed to be dug, Maulana Rafiuddin Saab, who was at the time the Muhtamim and the principal of the madrasa, he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his dream, and the Prophet said that Dig the foundations where you have decided to dig, because that will reduce the forecourt of the masjid. Push the foundations back by 15-20 yards. And in the dream, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he outlined the boundary. And with his asa, with his stick, and in the morning when Maulana Rafiuddin Saab woke up, and he went and he inspected where in his dream the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had outlined the boundary. He saw the line as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had outlined it, and then he, without any further consultation, he ordered on the foundations to be dug there, and then the building was built on top of that. And later on, as the number of students increased and mashallah, students started flocking, just as Darul uloom Deoband was the first madrasa established without government support, with public funding. Similarly, in Darul uloom Deoband, they then decided to build a building dedicated to the learning and teaching of hadith, and they called it Darul Hadith. This is the first building in Darul uloom Deoband, the Darul Hadith, throughout the Islamic world, dedicated purely to the name of hadith. They called it Darul Hadith. Allahu Akbar. And then as the students from Darul uloom Deoband started graduating and going back, Darul uloom Deoband was a center of attraction, not just for the people of Deoband and surrounding areas, but people from as far as Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, China, Burma, Iran, Afghanistan, Africa. Students came and then they studied under the prominent mashayikh of Darul uloom Deoband, and went back and established madrasas in their own countries as well. And then later on, when Pakistan gained its independence, in Karachi, people like Maulana Yusuf Binori, Maulana Muhammad Shafi, and Maulana Salimullah Khan Saab, they established their madrasas. Maulana Yusuf Binori Rahmahullah established a madrasa in Newtown. Mufti Muhammad Shafi Saab, who was originally from Deoband, studied there, became a teacher there, was the Mufti there as well for many years. And then when he came to Karachi, he established his madrasa there. Maulana Salimullah Khan Saab similarly established his madrasa, which is known as Jamia Faruqiya. These are all very grand institutions now, where many thousands of students are learning the Islamic sciences. And in Lahore, Jamia Ashrafia, in Multan, Khairul Madaris, in Akoda Khatak, Jamia Haqqaniya, and presently, there are more than 16,000 madrasas only in Pakistan, where more than 2 million students are learning the Islamic sciences. Hundreds of thousands of children are becoming huffaz and then ulama. And similarly in Bengal, in 1898, Atara Hazari Madrasa was established. And there are, mashallah, thousands of madrasas in Bangladesh now and throughout India. And then when the Muslims of the subcontinent came to England and to Britain in the 1960s, Hazrat Maulana Yusuf Mutala Sahab Damat Barakatum, they established a madrasa in Bari. That was the first Islamic institution in Europe. And then some of the graduates from Darul uloom Bari, people like Maulana Salim Durat Sahab, established their madrasas in Leicester Academies, Darul Ulooms, and mashallah, now throughout the UK, in Blackburn, in Bolton, and in Bradford, mashallah, there are various different madaris. And then as the ulama of Deoband went to the United States, in America, one of the disciples of Hazrat Sheikh Ul Hadith, rahimahullah, Dr. Ismail Sahab, established a madrasa in Buffalo, and there is now a Darul uloom in New York, Darul Ulooms in Canada, Darul Ulooms in South Africa, in Johannesburg, and Zakaria, in Azadville, in Durban, and in other parts of South Africa, and in Mozambique, in Zambia. The elder brother of Hazrat Maulana Yusuf Saab, Maulana Abdul Rahim Saab, he is running a madrasa in Zambia, in Australia, in other parts of the world. Mashallah, madaris have been set up by the sons of Darul uloom Deoband, and they are enlightening the world, just as Maulana Qasim Rahimahumullah had seen in the dream as a child. One of the oldest institutions in Makkatul Mukarrama is a madrasa which was established by the associates of Darul uloom Deoband. Maulana Rahmatullah Kiranvi, who was a friend of Maulana of Haji Imdadullah Muhajir Makki Rahimahullah, established a madrasa in Makkatul Mukarrama in the 1880s. and called it Madrasa Solatiya. Until recently, it was near the Haram, but when the buildings around the Haram in Makkah were demolished to make room for the extensions, then it was demolished, and where in front of Darul Tawheed presently, where there is the bus stand for SEPTCO buses, this is where Madrasa Solatiya was, and the authorities have given an alternative site on the outskirts of Makkah Tul Mukarramah for this madrasa. So the site has been transferred, but the madrasa still exists, and it's been run by the ulama of Deoband. When in the late 19th century, the Khalifa of the Usmani of Khilafat Usmani summoned Maulana Rahmatullah Kiranvi to Istanbul. When he heard about Madrasa Solatiya, he was informed that perhaps this is a training ground for a rebellion for the Khilafat. And the Khalifa summoned Maulana Rahmatullah Kiranvi, and Maulana Rahmatullah Rahimahullah clarified the issue. And then the Khalifa volunteered to take care of all the running expenses. And Maulana Rahmatullah said that the Khilafat is already doing grand work in throughout the Islamic world. Madrasa Solatiya is an honor for the Muslims of India. It was founded with their support and is being run with their support. So he requested the Khalifa to allow this madrasa to remain under the care of the Muslims of India, as it was a special honor for them. And he agreed. For over 130 years in Makkatul Mukarrama, the ulama of Deoband have been teaching Islamic sciences. Similarly, in Madinatul Munawwara, one of the ulama of Deoband, the elder brother of Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani, in 1921 established a madrasa there, and just behind Babul Baqi, which is the door leading to Masjid al-Nabawi through the in the direction of the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Madrasa Shara'iyya it was called, and it was functional until the 1980s, when the present extension was made. And it continued, and at the time, there were more than 600 children who were studying in Madrasa Shara'iyya, which was being run by the ulama of Deoband. And the ulama of Deoband, just as they pioneered the formation of madaris and their establishment, and in these madaris, there were mainly boys who would come and study. There was a need to establish institutions for girls as well. And throughout the history of Islam, you won't find any institution where girls used to go and gain structured Islamic education. Girls did gain Islamic education, but at home from their fathers or brothers who are ulama, but there were no institutions where girls used to go and gain structured Islamic education from the basics to completion through fiqh and tafsir and hadith. The ulama of Deoband pioneered, Allah gave them this honor as well, that they established madaris for girls as well. Initially in India, Pakistan, and then even in the UK, mashallah, in Lancaster, in Bradford, in Sheffield, there are various madaris, Darul uloom, where girls stay in boarding, and mashallah, are taught Arabic, are taught fiqh, are taught tafsir, and they top it all up with the dora of hadith. And in other parts of the country and world, daytime colleges and madaris are being run, where alimats are being trained. So Allah gave this honor to the ulama of Deoband as well. And the ulama of Deoband pioneered the study of hadith in a manner which was required in these changing and in these difficult times. Historically, the muhaddithun used to teach hadith with the sanad and the matan, explaining any difficulties which may be in the matan. And then different aqwals and madhahibs were also taught, but with the changing times in the situation in India, where there were Ahle Hadith rising as well, and they were beginning to criticize the Hanafi fiqh, that the Hanafis don't have any dalails from hadith, the ulama of Deoband pioneered the teaching of the Islamic sciences in the initial years, where a solid grounding was provided in sarf and nahv, and then fiqh, and then tafsir, and then hadith was taught in the final year. Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmizi, Nisa'i, Abu Dawud, and Ibn Majah. And they were taught in such a manner, with the reverence that hadith deserves. Unlike in many circles, where some hadith, which are particularly known as da'if hadith, are totally rejected. Many circles where hadith is discussed, and if it has been classified as da'if, it is totally rejected. Like Mirza Qadiani used to say, and he's written in volume 19 of Ruhani Khazain, page 140, he said, "I only accept those hadiths which conform to the Quran and my revelation. If there is any hadith which contradicts this, then," he says, "I throw it in the bin." And this is the respect or disrespect that he had for hadith. Similarly, in many circles, many hadith are rejected. But in Deoband, hadith was taught with the reverence that it deserves. As Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal were of the opinion, even a da'if hadith is better than no hadith. Even a da'if hadith is better than one's own opinion. At least it's a hadith, as long as it doesn't contradict sahih hadith and any aspect of the Quran, it is still a hadith. And it should be respected. But in Deoband, hadith were taught in such a manner, all the different aqwals of Sahaba and of A'imma and Fuqaha and Madhahib were mentioned, but the evidences for the Hanafi fiqh were taught as well and presented, and dalail given for why they are preferred. So there are dalail, and the ulama of Deoband weren't just simply ulama, they were fuqaha, they were mufassir, and they were muhaddis. Shaykhul Hind rahimahullah, people who have studied under him, and you listen to their reviews, Allahu Akbar. When Shaykh would give dars, Allahu Akbar, and the knowledge would flow from his tongue, people would realize, and the man is not talking, and they would think he's not talking with his tongue. Knowledge is flowing from his heart. And especially when it would come to the dalail or the aqwals and the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, and also when the Shaykh would talk about Sahih Bukhari, Allahu Akbar, it would be an honor to sit in his gathering and in his dars. And then the ulama which Deoband produced, Shaykhul Hind rahimahullah, who went on to become such a personality that most of the ulama in the Indian subcontinent are either his students, and then went on to become students of his students, or students of the students of the students of Shaykhul Hind rahimahullah. But directly the Shaykh taught people like Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanwi, Maulana Anwar Shah Kashmiri, Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani, Mufti Kifayatullah. These were all students, these were all ulama. And they were such people that they transformed, not only touched, but transformed the lives of millions of people. Maulana Anwar Shah Kashmiri Rahmatullah Alayhi, Allahu Akbar, it is said about him, he was Imam Bukhari, Ibn Hajar Asqalani, Allahu Akbar, all in one, he was a walking library. Allah had blessed him with such a memory. If he read a book, he would not forget it for the rest of his life. Mufti Muhammad Shafi Sahib Rahmahullah, Maulana Taqi Usmani rahimahullah has narrated an incident from his father, Mufti Shafi Saab, that while he was studying in Darul uloom Deoband, and he went up to see Shah Saab, Maulana Anwar Shah Kashmiri, and he asked him for an issue. And Shah Saab said, "Go and check such and such book in such and such volume on such and such page, and you will see it on the right side of the page." And Mufti Shafi Saab thought that perhaps the Shaykh has read this book recently, and he asked him, "Hazrat, when did you read the book?" He said, "I read this book 25 years ago." Allah had blessed him with such a memory. And then he had students like Maulana Idris Kandalwi and Maulana Badr-e Alam Mirati and Maulana Yusuf bin Nori, who was the muhaddis of his time. Allahu Akbar. And then Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanwi rahimahullah, who was regarded by many to be the mujaddid of the 14th century, as has been mentioned in a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, narrated by Imam Abu Dawood in his collection, "Inna Allah yab'athu li hadhihi al-umma ala ra's kulli 100 sanatin man yujaddidu laha deenaha." At the turn of every century, Allah will raise for in this ummah someone to revive deen. And And at the turn of every century and difficult times, Allah has raised such people, such grand scholars who have been able to inspire people and transform their lives and bring them back to Islam. Allahu Akbar. Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahimahullah, he traveled the length and the breadth of the country. His sermons were so popular, people will flock in their thousands to listen to his sermons and gave allegiance to him and were inspired by him. And Allahu Akbar. And Maulana, as well as his sermons and his spiritual inspirations, Maulana has left behind almost 1,000 writings. Many go into many volumes on tafsir, on hadith. Maulana also organized the writing and the compilation of a very special work. It's known as I'la'u Sunan by one of his nephew, Maulana Zafar Ahmad Usmani, in which the dalail of Fiqh Hanafi are presented from a hadith. It's in many volumes, and Maulana Zafar Ahmad Usmani, under the guidance of Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahimahullah, has compiled this unique and special compilation and collection of evidences for the Hanafi fiqh. Maulana himself wrote a tafsir of the Quran known as Bayanul Quran, and one of his disciples and students, Maulana Muhammad Mufti Shafi Saab, has written a tafsir, Ma'ariful Quran, which is extremely popular amongst ulama and the public, and is a very special tafsir. Other ulama as well, mashallah, also wrote tafsir. Shaykhul Hind rahimahullah, when he was imprisoned in Malta, he began writing a tafsir, which then one of his students, Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani, then completed. As a Shaykhul Hind rahimahullah began this tafsir in prison, but he was unable to complete it. He only wrote the first few ajza, and then Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani rahimahullah continued and completed it, and it's known as Tafsir Usmani. Many years ago, when in the King Fahad Academy they started publishing tafsir in different languages, Tafsir Usmani was chosen by the Saudi government, and it was printed in very large numbers and distributed throughout the world. And other ulama, Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani rahimahullah, also wrote a commentary on Sahih Muslim by the name of Fathul Mulhim. And Maulana Anwar Shah Kashmiri has written a commentary on Sahih Bukhari. Allahu Akbar. And then Maulana Khalil Ahmad Saharanpuri wrote a commentary on Abu Dawood, known as Badrul Majhood. And Maulana Zakaria rahimahullah has written a commentary on Muwatta Imam Malik. And Muwatta Imam Malik was referred to by Imam Shafi long before Imam Bukhari was born as the most authentic book after Kitabullah. And Maulana Zakaria rahimahullah has written a commentary on Muwatta Imam Malik in many volumes. And when the Maliki ulama became aware, they were astonished and amazed to how a non-Maliki Hanafi alim can have in-depth knowledge of the Maliki fiqh. And this was the qubuliyat Allah gave. This was the service that Allah took from the ulama of Deoband. And obviously, the other famous work of Maulana Zakaria rahmatullah alayhi, Fazale Amal. Many people have serious problems with Fazale Amal, but Allah has given this such acceptance throughout the world that perhaps after the Quran, it is probably the most read book throughout the Islamic world. It's been translated into many, many languages, including English, and is read in most masajid throughout the world and in most homes, and millions of people have benefited and gained inspiration through this book, Fazale Amal. Some people are critical that it contains some daif hadith as well. But Maulana Zakaria rahimahullah wasn't the only person who has brought daif hadith in his compilations. Imam Bukhari himself in his other works other than Sahih Bukhari has presented daif hadiths in Tirmizi, in Abu Dawud, in Nisa'i, and Ibn Majah, and most of the collections there are is Sahih hadiths and daif hadiths. So Maulana Zakaria rahimahullah isn't the first person to present the if hadiths, and in any case, they are only as a encouragement in fada'il. The people are not being asked to base their aqidah and fiqh issues on these daif hadiths. No, they are only encouragement, and the ulama and the muhaddithun have been accepting daif hadiths for centuries. So ulama of Deoband, Allahu Akbar, Allah bless them, and Allah enlighten the world with ulama who gained their inspiration and knowledge from Darul uloom Deoband. And other grand scholar to come from there, Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani, who after graduating from Darul uloom Deoband and decided to migrate to Madinatul Munawwara and taught hadith for almost 18 years in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He then returned to India and took up the post of Sadr Mudarris, of the headmaster in Darul uloom Deoband, and for mashallah for almost 60 years. For almost 60 years in his life he taught hadith. He taught hadith, Allahu Akbar. And the ulama which Deoband produced, not just ulama, they were fuqaha, they were mufassirun, they were muhaddisun, and they were revolutionary personalities. And the ulama of Deoband realized that it's all very good, mashallah, teaching Quran and hadith within the boundaries of the madrasa and the masjid. But the general masses and general public, they don't come to ulama, not everybody is willing to gain knowledge of deen, and people, as has been mentioned in hadith, annasu ala deeni mulukihim, people are on the deen of their rulers. So the ulama of Deoband realized that there is a need now for Muslims to involve themselves and to rise in the political field and to take an active part in the political struggle. At the time, the whole of India was controlled by the British, and things were very difficult for Muslims and for Hindus. And the ulama of Deoband, Shaykh al-Hind rahimahullah, in the later part of his life, when they realized that now is the time for Muslims to rise and take a political role. In the early years, they dedicated themselves to teaching and learning deen. This is also a part of wisdom, and that you understand what you need to do and when is the right time to do something. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah inspired him, and although Allah had given the Muslims victory in Badr, but when it was Hudaybiyah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam agreed to a truce on very difficult terms, and then returned to Medina, and this was an opportunity for Muslims to extend da'wah to other nations as well. So Muslims in the early years of Deoband's existence, they were aware that things are very difficult, so they took a passive role, and then they dedicated their attention and efforts to teaching and learning of deen. But when that knowledge had become safe and there were thousands of madaris, they had become established and ulama were now in the tens of thousands, so the Islamic sciences were now safe and the future of Islam was secured, so then and the ulama, Shaykh al-Hind rahimahullah, they decided it was now the right time to turn their attention to a political struggle in order to help the Muslims especially and the Indians generally to gain independence. And Shaykh al-Hind rahimahullah had been supporting the then crumbling Khilafat-e-Usmaniyah. Maulana Qasim Nanotwi rahimahullah, when he got married, he'd got married to Sheikh Karamat Sahib, who was a very rich man in Deoband. And so his wife brought a lot of jewelry and things with her when she got married. So the first time the Sheikh, Maulana Qasim Sahib, went to meet his wife and he saw all this jewelry, he said to her, "You are very rich and I am very poor. And so it will be very difficult for us to get along in this way. And we will only be able to get along if we are both at the same level. I can't become rich, but you can come down to my level." And he encouraged her, and she became willing to donate all her jewelry in order to support the struggle of Khilafat when they were fighting at the Russian fronts. So Maulana gave all that in charity. And when she returned to her home and her father realized that his daughter hasn't got the jewelry which he gave her, so he had even more made for her. So when she came back to Maulana Qasim Saab, Maulana repeated the same thing again, and she became willing to donate all her jewelry again, and then Allahu Akbar, and then she says, "After that I never ever felt like having more jewelry." And Allahu Akbar. So Maulana Qasim Saab, rahimahullah, in his own lifetime, he helped to support the then crumbling Khilafate Usmania, who was struggling at all fronts with the different European powers. And then Shaykh al-Hind, rahimahullah, when the Khilafate Usmania needed some funding, they ran a campaign throughout India for Muslims to support Khilafate Usmania, and they collected hundreds of thousands of rupees. And they sent them to support the Khilafate Usmania. And then upon his return, after being freed from the prison in Malta, and then the rest of the life, Shaykh al-Hind rahimahullah, spent traveling as much as he could in awakening the Muslims to rise for independence. But the Shaykh passed away very soon. And then Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani rahimahullah, he carried on in the footsteps of his teacher and took a very active and lead role in the struggle for independence, which then led to the formation of Pakistan in 1947. And Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani rahimahullah, in the early part of his political career, he supported Muslim League. But then when he saw that the Muslim League were not sincere and truthful in their promises, he took a step back, and then he saw a brighter future for Muslims in a united India with the Hindus. And his proposal was for a united India in which the Hindus would control or have 45% of the parliamentary seats, and the Muslims will also have 45% of the seats, and other minorities the other 10%. Muslim League wanted a separate state for Muslims, and they had their approach. But Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani rahimahullah, his vision was for a greater and a broader India with Muslims coexisting with Hindus. And because he felt that the areas for which Muslims were striving for independence, and they lacked the resources and infrastructure for a prosperous economy, and in any case, he felt that when Muslims migrated from India to Pakistan, then it would leave the rest of the Muslims in India vulnerable, because then they would be in a real minority. But he felt that if the Muslims stayed in a united India, they could have a greater influence in the economy and the politics, and it would be better for their future. And 65 years of independence of Pakistan have shown the worst of Maulana Hussain Ahmad Madani's fears to have come true, where Pakistan has struggled throughout its existence. And Islamically, Muslims of India have fared better than the Muslims of Pakistan. But Allahu Akbar, it was to be what was written in the taqdeer of Allah. But nevertheless, when Pakistan was formed, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, the founder of Pakistan, he was closest to ulama of Deoband than any other. And he gave Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani Deobandi, one of the sons of the initial founders of Darul uloom Deoband. Maulana Fazlur Rahman Sahib had three sons, Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani and Maulana Habibur Rahman Usmani, who was one of the became one of the muhtamams or principals of Darul uloom Deoband. And his other son was Mufti Azizur Rahman Sahib, who became the first Grand Mufti of Darul uloom Deoband. So Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani was given the honor of raising the Pakistan flag on the day of its independence. And then shortly before his death, Muhammad Ali Jinnah also gave the wasiyat. He wanted his janaza to be prayed, to be led by Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani. Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani was such a grand personality. In the 1920s, when the Saudi revolution took place, just as it has been mentioned in a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has forbidden people from building on top of graves. But the Turks had built many tombs in graveyards generally, and the green dome of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's the green dome on top of Rasulullah's grave was also built by the Turks. So when the Saudi revolution took place in the 1920s, with the support of the British, They demolished most of the tombs on graves, but when it came to the tomb of Rasulullah, they wanted to demolish that as well. And it is on record that a man, he climbed the roof of the Masjid al-Nabawi and started to demolish. And when he picked up the pickaxe to lay the blow, a lightning struck him and he was killed. And so this set the ulama back. So King Abdul Aziz in Riyadh, he called a meeting and he gathered as many ulama as he could from different parts of the Islamic world. Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani, who was on Hajj at the time, he was also given the opportunity to attend this meeting and gathering. And he was asked to put forward his views, and Maulana spoke for 2 hours. And he explained the hadith that in which the Prophet ﷺ has forbidden from building on top of graves. He said that this hadith is not applicable to the grave of Rasulullah and his tomb, because the Prophet has forbidden from building on top of graves. But when the grave of Rasulullah was dug, there was already a building in place, the Hujra of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So the tomb on top of the grave of Rasulullah is not on top of the grave, but rather on top of an already existing building. And so this hadith doesn't apply to the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in any case, because the Green Dome has over the centuries gained very sentimental importance throughout the Islamic world, and even Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was conscious of the sentiments of people, and he quoted the incident which has been mentioned by Imam Bukhari in his Sahih as well in Kitabul Hajj, that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed Hajj and Baytullah had been demolished by the Meccans before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's before the nubuwwat of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they had reduced its size because they ran short of funds, and they had excluded the area of Hatim from the construction of Baytullah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said to Aisha, "O Aisha, لولا حداثة قومك بالكفر لنقصت البيت ثم لبنيته على أساس إبراهيم. O Aisha, if your nation was not new in deen, then I would have demolished Baytullah and rebuilt it on the foundations of Ibrahim alayhi salam. But because the Arabs were so attached to Baytullah, and it would have been too much for them, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam abandoned this idea and left it to Allah. And Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, later on, he was aware of the Prophet's wish, so he demolished that side and had Baytullah rebuilt, incorporating Hatim within its boundaries. But then Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, because of his enmity to Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he then as well had demolished Baytullah and put it back the way it had been in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then later on, Imam Malik rahimahullah, he gave the fatwa and he forbid people from demolishing and rebuilding Baytullah in the future again, so that at least it becomes a practice where every khalifa will then try and rebuild Baytullah, and people will lose the respect for Baytullah. So the present construction is as was built by Hajjaj bin Yusuf. Over the centuries, when there was a need for renovation, Baytullah has been renovated but not rebuilt totally. So Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani rahimahullah in the court of King Abdulaziz spoke for 2 hours convincing the ulama that this hadith and this ruling doesn't apply to the tomb of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then after hearing his argument, then King Abdulaziz said to the Saudi ulama, "Ajib ul Hindi," and refute this Indian scholar. And then they were unable to answer his argument. And so the king said, he ordered that the tomb of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam be left. So this is a tribute to the sincerity and the piety and the qubuliyat of ulama Deoband in the eyes of Allah. And throughout the Islamic world, Allahu Akbar, the ulama of Deoband have held the flag of Islam high and continue to do so. And Allah has blessed ulama of Deoband just as they pioneered the establishment of madaris, initially for boys, for girls, and they pioneered the study of hadith, and they were the first people to establish even a building dedicated to the learning of hadith. And if you see, mashallah, the way hadith is taught in Darul uloom Deoband, many hundreds of students, mashallah, in that Darul Hadith, they are gathered in front of the Shaykh in his presence when he's delivering lecture on hadith. Presently, Maulana Saeed Ahmed Palanpuri is one of the senior ulama who teach Tirmizi Sharif there. Allahu Akbar. And throughout the Indian subcontinent, especially in the madaris affiliated with the ulama of Deoband, tens of thousands of ulama, they graduate annually having completed the study of Sahah Sitta. Similarly, Allah blessed the ulama of Deoband and that they pioneered a general revival in the ummah in the form of Tablighi Jamaat. Allah inspired one of the sons of Darul Uloom Deoband, Maulana Ilyas Kandalvi, who studied in Mazahirul Uloom. Initially, he was fortunate enough to see Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi as well. And then he studied under one of the disciples of Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, Maulana Khalil Ahmad Saharanpuri. Allahu Akbar. And then Allah inspired him and he started this revolution which has spread throughout the world. MashaAllah, from Fiji and Australia, Japan, in Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, throughout Asia, throughout Africa, in America, South America, North America, in the Russian states, Allahu Akbar, throughout the world, in many, many masajid, in every town you will find brothers and MashaAllah and sisters who are involved in this effort, and mashallah, people are engaged in the work of dawah, helping one another, encouraging one another to bring masses and the general public back to deen. Allahu Akbar, with inspiration, with encouragement, by encouragement to spare time and go in the path of Allah to learn deen and practice deen and propagate deen. This is such a revolution. You will not find another revolution the likes of Tablighi Jamaat, which has encompassed the whole ummah in the manner that Tabligh has. And this is sign of qubuliyat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ulama of Deoband are the ulama of Ahlus Sunnah. And they try and encompass all aspects of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's personality, inspiring people to learn Quran, yatlu alayhim ayatihi. Hundreds of thousands of huffaz graduate every year and Deobandi madaris. And Deoband was the benchmark, was the mother of all madaris. Other sects, Ahle Hadith, Shias and Brelvis, with time also established madaris. But Deoband was the mother of all madaris. Where hundreds of thousands of ulama of huffaz graduate every year, and throughout its history and the history of the madaris of Deoband, millions of huffaz have been produced. And yatlu alayhim ayatihi, learning and teaching of Quran, wa yuzakkihim. The ulama of Deoband went through the spiritual enlightenment processes, and as Allah has mentioned in the Quran, tazkiyah is such an important issue. Allah has mentioned this with so much emphasis. Wherever Allah mentions anything in the Quran important, Allah mentions it with a qasam, like wal asri, wat tini, wat zaytun, wat tur sinin, wa hadha al balad al amin. Some places one qasam, some two, some three, some four. There is one issue in the Quran which has been mentioned with seven qasams, and that is the issue of tazkiyah in Surah Washamsi wa Duhaha. Allah mentions, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Success is for those who attain purity of the nafs, and doomed are those who overlook this. Allahu Akbar. So the ulama of Deoband, where they focus on teaching, learning of Quran, of hadith, and tafsir, and fiqh, they have also given tazkiyah the importance that it deserves. Initially, the founders, under the guidance of Maulana Imdadullah Muhajir Makki Rahmahullah, who was the grand sheikh of his time, Maulana Muhammad Qasim Nanotwi, Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, Maulana Zakriya, Maulana Khalil Ahmad Saharanpuri Rahmahumullah, these were all grand scholars and grand spiritual personalities as well. Many people have got serious issues with the ulama of Deoband and have laid baseless criticisms upon them. And recently on the YouTube, someone has put up a clip saying the Deobandi recipe for becoming Allah, in which They have quoted a small passage from some of Haji Imdadullah Muhajir Makki Rahimahullah's books, whereby the Shaykh, while prescribing dhikr, he says that a person should do so much dhikr that until his heart becomes enlightened with the dhikr of Allah, and he can feel the presence of Allah in his heart. And he says, then the person who's put up this clip goes on to say, Mirza Qadiani laid a claim to being Nabi, but Deobandis, they lay a claim to becoming Allah. Na'uzu billah min zalik. All these claims show the ignorance and the arrogance of people who are making these accusations. If only they had any knowledge, understanding of hadith, then this is a hadith mentioned in Bukhari, Sahih Hadith Qudsi, in which Allah says that when I take someone to be my beloved, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يَبْصُرُ بِهِ وَيَدَهُ الَّذِي يَبْتِشُ بِهَا. Allah says that when a person continues drawing himself near to Allah, Allah takes him to be his beloved. So much so that Allah becomes his eyes with which he sees. Allah becomes his ears with which he hears. Allah becomes his hands with which he holds and his legs with which he walks. So in this Sahih Hadith Qudsi mentioned by Imam Bukhari rahmahullah, told by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah is saying, I become his eyes, I become his ears, I become his hands, I become his legs. So do we ever say that someone is special, someone pious, Allah is his eyes, or Allah is his ears, or Allah is his hands? So when this means that all aspects of a person's life, they become subject to Allah's pleasure. So similarly, Haji Sahib has mentioned the same thing. So people make baseless accusation. Maulana Muhammad Qasim Nanotvi Rahmahullah was such a grand person, so humble. He had so much love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that when he would hear the Prophet's name, he would begin to shiver. When he went to Hajj, he spent all his time walking around Madinatul Munawwara bare feet. And he said, I can't walk about in this blessed and noble city where Rasulullah used to walk, and I can't walk with shoes on. Allahu Akbar. His feet developed blisters, but he didn't care. And he had so much love for Rasulullah, he's written some poetry, and in one of his couplets he says, Oh Allah, if only I can be considered among the dogs of Medina. And people say, look, Allah made him human and he wants to be a dog. Why does he want to be a dog? Allahu Akbar. But if anybody had any knowledge of Quran and the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would know. And if people would act upon the teachings of Rasulullah, as the Prophet has said, has encouraged people to read Suratul Kahf every Friday. And in Surah Kahf, Allah has narrated an incident whereby some youngsters, they had newly come into Islam or into Deen and had brought Iman, and they felt their Iman to be in danger, and they thought when their parents find out, then they might be pressurized into giving up their faith. So they left and they sought refuge in a cave. They were accompanied by their dog. When they lay down to rest, Allah put them to sleep. And their dog as well. Allah says, وَكَلْبُهُمْ بَاسِتٌ ذِرَاعِهِ بِالْوَسِيدِ. And their dog was with them as well. So some mufassirun have stated that if the dog, that the dog of the youngsters of the cave, Allah will give him a human appearance and admit him into paradise as well. So if the dog of some youngsters, new Muslims, who aren't even prophets or anything, if he can have so much importance, if someone was to be considered the dog of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidul Mursaleen, what importance will he have in the eyes of Allah? So all these criticisms are baseless. Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi rahimahullah, a very saintly person, very humble, in one of his letters to his sheikh, has written that, I am a liar. Here he's referring to his taqwa, his piety, that people think I am so pious and so good, but he says in reality I am nothing. And so people say, look, Rashid Ahmad Gangohi himself confesses to be a liar. But if anybody had any knowledge of the lives of Sahaba, he would know there is no one better in this ummah than Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, once he was going and he met Hanzala. Hanzala radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to him, oh Abu Bakr, Hanzala has become a munafiq. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, Hanzala, how can you say that? And he said, Abu Bakr, you know what? When we are with Rasulullah, our hearts are so soft. When we go home, we become engaged in dunya. So that feeling we have in the company of Rasulullah vanishes. And so I find that I have become a hypocrite. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, well, I go through the same feeling. So they went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet said, this doesn't happen all the time. If you were to have the same feeling that you have in my presence all the time, then angels would shake your hands and be with you all the time. But this only happens on occasions. So Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, fear for nifaq for himself, and nifaq is much worse. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. Not that Abu Bakr na'uz billah was ever a munafiq. No. Similarly, Mawlana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi rahimahullah, out of his humbleness, he's claiming to be a liar. Not that he was a liar. And this was from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's life. Allah has mentioned an incident in the Quran with regards to prophets. Allah will ask the prophets on the day of Qiyamah, يَوْمَ يَجْمَعُ اللَّهُ الرُّسُلَ فَيَقُولُ مَاذَا أُجِبْتُمْ. When Allah will gather the prophets and ask them, how did the people respond to you? Allah says in the Quran, قَالُوا لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا. So obviously when the prophets did tabligh, they knew how the people responded. But on the day of Qiyamah, they will say, Ya Allah, we have no knowledge. In other words, out of the fear of Allah, they will say, Ya Allah, you know better. Everything is in your knowledge. What we understand and what we see might not necessarily be right. So any criticism anybody lays on the ulama of Deoband, it shows their own ignorance, rather arrogance. And to have any grudge in any person's heart for any of these saintly personalities, it says in Hadith Qudsi, مَنْ عَادَ لِي وَلِيًّا فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Whosoever has any grudge in his heart for any one of my friends, Allah says, I challenge them to war. Come, let me sort you out. Let me teach you a lesson. Allahu Akbar. So the ulama of Deoband, they were the ulama of Ahlu Sunnah. They were the ulama of Haqq. They were revolutionary personalities. Allah chose them to revive his deen throughout the world. So may Allah grant us their love. And may Allah enable us to make the most of these blessed people. As Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ittaqullaha wa kunu ma'as sadiqeen. O those who believe, fear Allah and join the truthful people. And so the ulama of Deoband were truthful people. They were sincere people. And the legacy that Deoband has left behind, it's a tribute to the sincerity, to their piety, to their taqwa, to their qubuliyat in the eyes of Allah. May Allah Rabbul Alameen grant us their love. As has been mentioned in hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Al-mar'u ma'a man ahab. A man or a person will be with the people that he loves. So may Allah Rabbul Alameen enlighten our hearts with his love. Love for his brother Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. Arju ridaka ya Allah, anta ar-rahimu ya Allah.